And welcome to the sixth of the eight-part series, seminar series on the topic of discussion for today on the impact of leapfrogging and large infrastructure build on Africa's development potential. My name is Pamela Gopal, and I'm the lead coordinator of the Policy Bridge Tank Program at the African Union Development Agency, NEPAD. This seminar series is co-hosted by AUDA-NEPAD and the Institute for Security Studies. The AUDA-NEPAD Policy Bridge Tank Program seeks to actively integrate the knowledge content generated by think tanks for evidence-informed policymaking. And therefore, we have partnered with the African Futures and Innovations Program of the Institute of Security Studies, who are the specialists in providing meaningful contributions through Africa's broader economic transformation to support both national and regional development plans and processes. The African Futures and Innovations Program brings foresight analysis, which integrates the International Futures Modeling Platform and serves to analyze complex and the long-term dynamics of change in human, social, and natural systems. The aim today is to share resources with policymakers, academics, the private sector, international organizations, multilateral agencies, and others seeking to improve the ways we contemplate and plan for the global future. The leapfrogging scenario shows the potential impact of modern technologies such as digital mobile communications, drones, and the widespread use of a decentralized renewable energy system to unlock more rapid economic growth and steadily crowd large sections of Africa's large informal sector into the formal economy. Africa's current economic infrastructure deficit and its impacts on the continent's development outlook will also be explored, and a combined scenario will be presented to you today. We are delighted that you are joining us today, and we look forward to a fruitful and engaging dialogue. And we are presenting today two brief presentations, and we are joined by three discussants, and who I will introduce to you later. But for now, I wish to introduce to you to Dr. Jakkie Cilliers. Dr. Cilliers is the ISS founder and former executive director of the ISS. He currently serves as the chair of the ISS Board of Trustees, and he heads the Africa Future and Innovation Program at the Pretoria Office of ISS. His 2017 bestseller, Fate of the Nation, addresses Africa's future from political, economic, and social perspectives. His three most recent books, Africa First, Igniting a Growth Revolution, which was launched in March 2020, the Future of Africa Challenges and Opportunities, launched in April 2021, and Africa Tomorrow, which is Pathways to Prosperity, in June 2022, take a rigorous look at the continent as a whole. Dr. Jakkie will share the platform today with Dr. Blessing Chipanda. Dr. Chipanda joined the African Futures and Innovations Program in January 2023. Before joining ISS, he worked as an assistant lecturer and research assistant at the University of Pretoria. The Department of Economics is particularly interested in tasks within the wider realm of international trade, development economics, public policy, monetary policy, and econometric modeling. Equally interested in economic and social economic activities that impact social welfare. Dr. Blessing has a PhD in economics from the University of Pretoria, South Africa. With that, over to you, Jakkie, and welcome to this platform again.
Thank you very much, Pamela. So as you indicated, Blessing and I are going to share the presentation today. I'm going to start, and I'm going to, as is normal, going to take you to the website of the African Futures and Innovation team, so that we can speak from there. So what I'm showing you at the moment is the front page of the website. I want to first start off by navigating you to something that is known as the About the Website, so I can explain what we've done on this website. So the website was launched towards June of last year by the CEO of AUDA-NEPAD and in the presence of the South African President, Cyril Ramaphosa. And what we do is reflected in the short summary in front of you. We measure progress towards the Africa Union's Agenda 2063 vision through the individual and combined impact of various scenarios on the future of Africa. It's five regions, such as North Africa, the eight regional economic communities, such as ECOWAS, country income groups, such as the average for Africa's low-income countries and individual countries. The forecast horizon is to the end of the third 10-year implementation plan of Agenda 2063 in 2043. If you scroll down, and let me just make the point that we work in partnership with NEPAD. So all our work is in support of AUDA-NEPAD and towards Agenda 2063. If you scroll down, you will be able to see some material about Agenda 2063. But where I want to take you is a detail here about the modeling platform, the International Futures Forecasting Platform that is hosted by our partners at the Frederick S. Pardee Center at the University of Denver. Apart from just pointing you to where you can find detail on the modeling platform, and I'm not going to be discussing the modeling platform now, there is one important component here, and that relates to groups. I'm going to be referring to a variety of groupings, and all the groups that we use are listed in the About section. In particular, I'm going to compare some of Africa's development prospects with what happens in East Asia, South America, and South Asia, these last two regions in particular. Just to tell you where you can find detail about the modeling platform, as well as the regionalization that we use. I'm going back to the main page of the website, because today what we have is we have a little bit of a complicated presentation. Let me start off by making the point that we forecast the future of every African country. And if you click on the geographic section of the website, the countries are listed there, the regions, the regional economic communities, and the income groups. And we forecast the future of each of these countries, and our modeling is done at a country level and is then aggregated up to regions like ECOWAS. We forecast the future of every African country on first looking at its so-called current path, where we think that country is headed at the moment. And then we have various themes, like demographic, agriculture, health and wash, education, manufacturing, continental free trade area, leapfrogging, financial flows, large infrastructure and governance. And we combine these themes in a combined presentation of the impact of all of these themes on the future of Africa. What makes our presentation today a little bit complicated is that we have combined two themes into a single scenario. We have done that on a number of the themes on the Institute. For example, on the website, for example, we have combined demographics and health and wash, because they are closely related. What we have done is we have also combined leapfrogging and large infrastructure in a single scenario. We discuss them separately as a theme, but then we have a single combined scenario in which we present their future. And that's what we're going to be discussing in this Erudite series. There is lots of additional material on the website with regard to the impact of work and jobs, of the various scenarios on work and jobs and climate change, and the impact of development in the rest of the world on Africa. But I want to move to the first of the sections that I want to present, which is on large infrastructure. Before I do that, on that drop-down menu that you can see at the moment, for each of these scenarios or themes, We look at where the country is going on its current path, and then we look at the impact of, for example, large infrastructure on the future of Africa. So I've gone to the large infrastructure on the website, and everything that I'm presenting to you is available on the website. If you would like to navigate, for example, on large infrastructure, and you scroll down on this page, you will come, things will happen. The first is there will be a pop-up menu on the left that gives you a summary of the content for this theme. Second is that the theme opens up what we refer to as a slider, in this case, large infrastructure, top 10 takeaways. This summarizes the main impact of all the work that we've done that is reflected in this long content menu on the left. For example, if I were to scroll down on the slider, I keep my mouse in the slider and I just scroll down in the slider, it tells us that infrastructure central to Africa's future, according to the African Development Bank, it accounts for over 50% of recent improvements in economic growth and has the potential to even achieve more. So there, in each of these sliders, there is only 10 points, 10 takeaways. Second big takeaway just says that inadequate infrastructure in sub-Saharan Africa is a major obstacle. It's a binding constraint on the development of regional value chains, productivity growth, regional, international trade, and environmental protection. It says that in spite of significant progress, Africa trails its peers. And according to the World Bank, the infrastructure gap in sub-Saharan Africa cuts national economic growth by 2 percentage points every year and reduces productivity by as much as 40%. In 2019, for example, almost 600 million Africans had no access to electricity, 78% of the world's total population without access to electricity. And Africa had only 26% paved roads, of its roads were paved. Five, it says that funding is a key challenge. In 2019, governments in sub-Saharan Africa spent 3.8% of GDP on infrastructure, while the World Bank estimates that it needs to invest 7.1% of GDP each year until 2030 to address the infrastructure gap. African national governments have historically financed the largest share of the continent's infrastructure development, complemented recently by loans from China. But today, large debt levels constrain future building. And then it sets out a scenario which Blessing is going to discuss. And there are a number of additional points. Now, before I move away from infrastructure, I go back to the content menu on the left, and I'm going to click here on all charts for the theme. What this does, it lists all the charts that are available in the theme. And I want to go to this chart, access of electricity. And what we do here, for example, all these charts are interactive and so on. And let me make that a little bit smaller, so it's more clearly available, visible on your screen, or that full chart is visible on your screen. The title of the chart says access to electricity total urban and rural in Africa by income group for 2009, 2019, and 2043. So this is Africa. And this is percent of population 2009, 2019, and 2043. And this is total, in this case, total access to electricity in Africa, and it compares that for 2009, 2019, 2043, South America and South Asia. Now, our current path forecast, this is what it represents, what the situation was in 2019 and what we expect on the current path it will go to by 2043. So you can immediately see access to electricity, the difference between Africa and the two regions that we compare with Africa, the other two developing regions, South America and South Asia. And I showed you that in the About section on the website, you can go and find the exact composition of those regions. Now, this is urban. If I were to show you the rural situation, you can clearly see the deficit that that Africa has compared to South America and South Asia. And you can explore the detail, but I want to do something else. I want to point you to the difference between North Africa, So I'm going to take Africa out here. I'm going to show you North Africa as an average. And I'm going to compare North Africa, not with South America and South Asia, but with Sub-Saharan Africa. Because the differences, Africa is one region, but the differences are quite stark. So this is rural access, electricity access for Sub-Saharan Africa, 2009, 2019, and our current power forecast till 2043, compared to North Africa. So this is where the large deficit in electricity access occurs. So this is one way to look at, for example, the infrastructure deficit in Africa. Another way would be, let's go in this instance to paved roads. And again, I'm comparing Africa with South America and South Asia. This is a percent of total roads that is paved in 1990, 2019, 20, and our current path forecast till 2043. And you can see the extent to which things in Africa, firstly, are not progressing very rapidly compared to, for example, South America. And of course, South Asia, which has a much higher base. And one can again look at the difference between, for example, North Africa versus Sub-Saharan Africa. So I'm going down to North Africa, and I'm selecting Sub-Saharan Africa, because the differences between these two sub-regions of Africa are huge. For example, the percent of total roads in Sub-Saharan Africa by 2043, that's two decades into the future, will only get to about 47%, whereas in North Africa, it will get to about 85%. So there are different ways that we can play around with the extent of infrastructure and Africa's infrastructure deficit, and you can choose any country or any region. Let me take a third index, whatever one says, go to chart 9, access to internet, because we know that Africa, when it comes to mobile internet, is doing quite well. So here again, we look at Africa versus South America versus South Asia. On the left-hand side is mobile broadband access. On the right-hand side is fixed broadband access. And this is subscription 100 people. We can see that Africa doesn't, when it comes to mobile broadband, does not do badly when it comes to the forecast, very rapid progress in Africa. And when we compare that to South America and South Asia, when it comes to fixed broadband, we also see that these are also regions that struggle. Now, while Africa is moving very rapidly on mobile broadband access, we must remember that business requires fixed broadband. It requires more data and dependable data than ordinary households. So this is another way to look at Africa's infrastructure deficit. But Africa is rapidly leapfrogging when it comes to mobile broadband access. And that, against that background, I want to now shift to the leapfrogging theme. To do that, I go to the top of the drop-down menu and I go to leapfrogging. Because we believe that one of the main, that a lot of Africa's development potential is in one sense linked to leapfrogging, a rollout of ICT, which allows a lot of advantages. Our thinking and the modeling we've done is very distinct. But before I do that, I first want to again scroll down on the page on the theme on leapfrogging. Again, if you click on the contents, there is a summary of the contents on this. And there is what we refer to as a slider, and that has the top 10 takeaways. That slider says that the uptake and social effects of new technology at scale are pronounced in developing countries able to short-circuit path dependency. It could lead to stage skipping and open up alternative development pathways. Long-term impact of modern technology at scale is greater independence and more choice, but could deepen inequality because modern technology can empower the individual. requirements for leapfrogging in Africa are access to electricity and stable broadband. But in 2023, only 45% in sub-Saharan Africa had electricity access. We saw that in the previous theme. In North Africa, it was 98%. Only 3 persons per 100 had fixed broadband, and 49 out of 100 had mobile broadband. In North Africa, it's 11 out of every 100 and 104 out of every 100. Energy access will come to Africa through distributed household and mini grids using solar, wind, and geothermal, and better energy storage systems, and new technologies such as hydrogen and waste to biomass conversion. Internet access will come to Africa through upgrading from dominant 3G to 5G systems, additional cable access that circles the continent, and large-scale systems such as low-level satellites that connect directly to smartphones. And then again, it refers us to the joint large infrastructure and leapfrogging that a blessing is going to speak about. Then just two charts, because I gave you that background, firstly on infrastructure and now on leapfrogging, because the way what we think is the most important contribution that leapfrogging will make to Africa's development is on the size of Africa's informal sector. So here is a chart that presents the size of the size of the labor force that is active in the informal sector and the percent of GDP of the informal sector. This is for Africa. Again, let me go to North Africa versus Sub-Saharan Africa. Going to click on North Africa and Sub-Saharan Africa. I'm just going to remove Africa from our drop-down menu. Now you will see that the labor force in Sub-Saharan Africa that are engaged in the informal sector is much higher than that of North Africa. Again, our forecast is from 2019, just before COVID, until 2043. And that the percent of GDP in the informal sector is much higher in Sub-Saharan Africa than it is in North Africa. Why is this important? A large informal sector is a drag on growth, and all economies all try to formalize the informal sector. And we believe that modern technology will exactly do this. What modern technology will do, it allows what we refer to as going more rapidly up the informality staircase. This is an effort to depict what I'm speaking about. The traditional business progression was that you were either in the informal or the formal sector, and that the barriers from the one to the other were quite high. But modern technology, particularly internet access and smartphones, allow you to progress incrementally to formalization. Just think of the extent to which there are many countries are rolling out ID systems, for example, and that allows the more rapid formalization of the informal sector. So, Pamela, thanks very much. I'm now going to hand over to Blessing to speak about how we took these two areas, large infrastructure and leapfrogging, and combined them and built a scenario for that, and then looked at the impact of that. So I'm going to stop sharing and hand over to Blessing.
Thank you. Thank you. And before Blessing takes over, Jakkie, I just want to thank you for that interactive, walk through the site. I want to encourage the participants that the site, the link to the site is made available on the chat group, as well as the thematic area that's discussed today. The link is available on the chat group for you to access. And if you can please, as the speakers are speaking, feel free to post your comments on the Q&A. Over to you, Dr. Blessing.
Oh, thank you, Pamela. Let me share my screen with you guys. Okay. Can you all see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. So what we did in this scenario, What we did, we increase electricity access ratio, we reduce electricity transmission loss, we reduce capital cost to output ratio, we increase productivity of hydro and other renewable energies. We also increased access to internet, fixed and mobile broadband, and we also reduced the size of informal sector and the cost of adding internet access to broadband. We also increased the share of paved road, both in rural and in urban. We also increased government spending on other infrastructure, which is rail, airports. All these interventions, they result in economic growth and social growth. So all the in this intervention, what we did, we start our intervention from 2024 up to 2033. Then we keep them constant up to 2043. So all these interventions pushed African government spending on infrastructure from 3.6% of GDP to 4.2% of GDP, which is a 0.6% of GDP increase. So let me take you to the impact. Okay. Let me show you the impact on growth. So by increasing Africa's government spending on infrastructure by 0.3%, by 0.6%, Africa growth will increase from 5.2% to 5.5% in 2043, which is a 0.3% increase relative to the current path. And with Somalia, DRC, Eritrea recording the highest growth in 2043 relative to the current path. Let's look at the impact on GDP per capita. So to start off, the scenario will increase Africa's GDP per capita by about $345 relative to the current path, which is from 7,059 to $7,405 in US dollar 2027. So at country level, here at the excesses, we have got US dollar at 2027. I'm going to show you the absolute value. So at country level, we can see that there will be a higher increase in GDP per capita in Eswatini, Gabon, Liberia, and Namibia relative to the current path. I can also show you the percentage change relative to the current path. We can see that the percentage change relative to the current path, we see a larger increase from Madagascar, Liberia, Sierra Leone, Burundi. Let me show you the impact on extreme poverty. Let me start by showing you the impact on Africa as a whole. So the scenario will lift 37.8 million African people out of extreme poverty in 2043 at $1.90. At country level, so on the x-axis, this is the number of people that will be lifted out of extreme poverty. And the green line, this one is the current path. And the light green is our scenario. So you can see the margin from 398 million in the current path to 360 million point two in our scenario. So a reduction of 37.8 million people. Oh, let me take you to the impact. At country level, so at country level, we see that a lot of people from Nigeria will be lifted out of extreme poverty compared to the current path, followed by the population from DRC, Tanzania, Mozambique, and Madagascar. I can show you the percentage changes. The percentage changes of the population relative to the current path, the y-axis, we see that it will be Madagascar, Sierra Leone, Mozambique, Liberia. But this doesn't say much because it's like we are comparing where it was and to where it was going. For example, it can be a reduction from 1 to 2, then it can reflect as 100% reduction in poverty. So it's better to use the absolute value that can exactly tell us the number of people that have been lifted out of extreme poverty in 2043. So let me take you to the impact on trade. So for Africa, the increase of GDP of African government spending on infrastructure by 0.6% will increase Africa's export in 2043 from 2.2 billion in the current path to 2.3 billion in our scenario. And imports will increase from 2.7 billion in 2043 in the current path to 2.8 billion in 2043 in our scenario. So let's look at the impact at country level. At country level, in terms of total trade, we can see that there will be a larger increase in total trade in Nigeria, followed by Egypt, Angola, DRC. When we look at exports, total export, we can see also that Nigeria will dominate, followed by Egypt, Angola, DRC. When it comes to imports, we can see that there will be also an increase in imports to Nigeria, Egypt, and Mozambique. And we can see here for Sudan that there will be a decrease in imports. So I think here there will be a trade diversion and trade creation in Sudan. As we can see that there will be a reduction in import, it means maybe the increase in spending on infrastructure will push on production, productivity, and research and development, research and innovation in Sudan, that will reduce the value of imports. Just to go back to exports, we can also see that the number of exports from from Kenya to Liberia will also decrease. These are exports to the world, not just to intra-Africa. So here we see trade divergent in Kenya and Liberia, as the improvement in infrastructure will also make other countries' production or exports more cheaper relative to Kenya and Liberia. So, in conclusion, I can say for Africa to leapfrog, expanding household electricity, access, mobile broadband are the key enabler for leapfrogging in Africa. Household electricity access can be ramped up rapidly through decentralization of off-grid, wind and solar, breaking through in energy storage, hydrogen, and the use of bio will assist Africa. African government must apply the following in the digital and energy space: innovate business model, flexible, clear, and transparent regulatory frameworks, and effective governance in the public and private sector. The African government must also practice good governance by preventing corruption in the public procurement process and by establishing transparent competition and accountability in the procurement. They must also increase public investment in infrastructure, particularly public regional infrastructure, as many of African government development challenges require cross-border solution. For example, the development of regional value chains that can also make African countries compete in the global value chain. And also the full implementation of AFTA requires improvement in infrastructure development to facilitate the supply chains. The African government must also promote public-private partnership and private investment, particularly in the development of sustainable public and regional infrastructure by strengthening the rule of law, reducing corruption, improve regulatory quality, implement institutional reforms, and minimize political uncertainty. I'll end here. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Blessing, for that insightful presentation. And it only tells us that countries that continuously conduct foresight studies and that integrates these results systematically in policymaking see the development of supporting measures and needs in their programs. And we see that they perform much better in the national innovative performance than other countries. In general, I think foresight studies that you've demonstrated are also generally considered as something positive in most countries, where evaluations of these studies show that it has significant impact on the structure of innovation, on technology, on science policy. And this certainly demonstrates a positive function and role on the innovative culture and awareness for innovation in different countries. So thank you very much for that informative demonstration on leapfrogging and infrastructure. I would like now to move to our eminent discussants. We will start this session with Dr. Frieda Jorsen. Dr. Frieda is a development professional with more than 10 years of experience in public policy advisory, management consulting, and mechanical engineering. Currently, Frieda serves as the senior manager for infrastructure and innovation at the African Center of Economic Transformation ASSET. ASSET is an Accra-based think tank. And prior to that, she has served as the senior program manager, where she managed the organizational portfolio, reporting, and worked across multiple African countries, bringing governments and development partners and stakeholders together to address policy reform and in the areas of such as skills and manufacturing. Dr. Frieda is an engineer and has worked also in community infrastructure projects, addressing water purification at the Dominican Republic, in Ghana, as well as Honduras. And she received her master's in international affairs at the CIPA at Columbia University, and her Bachelor of Engineering, Mechanical Engineering at the University of Michigan. With that, I would like to hand over to you, Dr. Frieda, and thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Pamela. And I wish I could say I was a doctor. My dad would be very happy to hear that, as he wants me to finish my PhD. But I appreciate that. First of all, just thank you very much for this invitation to join this wonderful discussion on what Africa's future could look like in terms of our infrastructure. Your papers really went through a great analysis of what our potential could be if we tweak these levers in electricity, digitalization, and broadband infrastructure. And we can see very clearly that if we are able to put in some of these recommendations, obviously it will have a significant impact to African, especially sub-Saharan African economies. So I very much appreciated that analysis. I think, however, one of the big questions that stands out to me and for the researchers is more around the how, right? So in your large infrastructure paper, for instance, I love that you shed a little bit of light on some of the countries like DRC, Congo, and what the issues are as they attempt to finance issues around the political economy, all of that. So I would have loved to see a little bit more around how we do that practically to achieve these futures. And perhaps maybe I could just lend a few points towards the how as we also analyze what the futures look like. So you mentioned already that financing is a huge issue, and that those contributions to financing, come from a large infrastructure investment gap that I know AUDA-NEPAD is working on. But I think one of the things I'd like to highlight is a regional approach to development, which I know PETA is working on, and the opportunities we have to leapfrog if we actually leverage cross-border infrastructure projects, especially when it comes to the traditional areas like road and rail and transportation in general. And so I'd like to recognize, for instance, a few months ago, we had a peer learning event with AUDA-NEPAD and others, where we brought 12 countries together, and we realized that as we were talking about issues of, for instance, project development, many of the countries were very comfortable developing and financing projects at the national level. But when it came to working across two or three countries, we realized that many of them didn't have the capacity to structure those types of projects. And so these are examples of some very practical ways in which we can make those efforts towards leapfrogging. Another thing that we also realize is that, many of us are not catalyzing on the learnings that we have across national projects. And one example of a project that's trying to do that is AFIDA's Catapult Accelerator, which it brings together smaller scale developers to build their capacity to develop some of these projects and to learn from each other. And I think the final thing that I would also say is that, things like renewable energy, hydro, wind, they're great things to aspire to. But for instance, in very early when I was doing some research on wind energy in Ghana, I realized that there were just about two or three areas in the country where you could actually get the level of wind energy that you needed to drive significant amounts of energy production. So we need more support in areas where we can do these types of research and feasibility assessments to see if these types of renewable energy options are practical. For instance, hydrogen is great, but production of hydrogen is very cost intensive, right? And so there is great opportunity also, especially in our local innovation ecosystems. As someone who has, you know, an innovation lab myself, I know some of these realities where you may be trying to build a product. You mentioned product design and manufacturing in your paper, but you are running into issues with the cost of inputs and being highly taxed and, you know, not having a lot of red tape and certification and all of these things. And so enabling local innovators to also be able to drive R&D in these areas is something that governments can also contribute to. So I know I've said a lot. I think maybe I'll stop here and then allow some of the other participants to continue. Thank you very much for a wonderful analysis. Very much appreciated.
Thank you very much for your intervention and for being able to join us today. And I think what you said last about stressing the fact of R&D, as you know, my colleagues here in the space of R&D always say, Africa, you know, just touches on less than 1% of investment in R&D in the continent, whereas developing countries reach up to 3%. And I think, you know, it's really correct if we focus on that. And these, you know, foresight analysis actually prompts a lot of this research in countries. So thank you again for that. Without further ado, we are moving across very quickly because of time constraints. I would like now to introduce you to Professor Arun Tesfai. He is a professor and the chair of the Department of Political Science at William Paterson University in New Jersey. He received his BA and his MPA degrees from the University of California State University, Frenzo, and his PhD from the Center of Politics and Economics, Claremont Graduate University in Claremont in California. He is an author of several books and many scholarly articles. He publishes, his publications include China in Ethiopia, The Long-Term Perspective, State and Economic Development in Africa, The Case of Ethiopia, The Political Economy of the Nile Basin Regime in the 20th Century, Political Power and Ethnic Federalism, The Struggle of Democracy in Ethiopia. He has taught in the Departments of Economics and Political Science at the California State University and is the faculty and in the Faculty of Social Science in UNISTAD in San Jose, so and as well as the People's Republic of China. So with that, sir, your CV is really impressive, and we are fortunate to have you here today. So thank you very much, and over to you, Professor Tesfai. You're on mute. Please unmute. Thank you.
Thank you, Pam, and the organizers for inviting me. Great presentation by Jakkie and Blessing also. Thank you. I should be open and say that I'm familiar with the AU agenda. Agenda 63, but truly I was not familiar with African futures, and this is something that I would look into as time passes on. I agree with Freda, the test is in implementation. And I think Blessing has mentioned some of it, because during the presentation by Jakkie and Blessing, I was kind of wondering about what are the determinants of leapfrogging? Again, the conundrum is on implementation. And so I think everybody knows the challenge. The challenge is African states are weak in terms of, particularly Sub-Saharan Africa, in terms of institutions. The state is strong at the same time weak. Strong because it can deliver violence, but it's weak because it cannot deliver the political and economic goods. Second, when we talk about the state, we're talking about the bureaucracy, state capacity to implement policy. It varies across sub-Saharan African countries. And the third is human capital, of course, you know, very important. In terms of financing for development, there are the traditional bilateral institutions, of course, in the West, the European Union and the US, the World Bank and the IMF, but they all have their own conditionality. You know, on the top of my head, I'm thinking, you know, maybe what Africa needs is some kind of a Marshall Plan, but that's not going to happen, and so forth. In terms of FDI, foreign direct investment in Africa, there are preconditions, of course, for this: political stability and security, and they exist in varying degrees in sub-Saharan Africa. And so even though the African Union has been talking about silencing the guns, we still see conflict in sub-Saharan Africa, from West Africa to the Horn of Africa, and so forth and so on. My area of work, I belong, besides my institutional duty at my university, I also belong to the Afro-Sino Center for International Relations, Accra, Ghana, where I head the IPE, the International Political Economy pillar, and where we cultivate African scholars, emerging African scholars, to write about Africa. Currently, China-Africa relations the literature is basically written by Europeans and by Asians, by Americans. We want African voices. And so that is where I am. And of course, you know, when we talk about Afro-Sino relations, we're talking about the Chinese in Africa, you know. And people have a take on that. Some claim the Chinese are colonialists, some claim no, they're not, they're still a third-world country, they're basically investing in Africa, etc., etc. So the jury is out on that, but there is Chinese investment in Africa, massively also. It depends on from country to country, Angola, Mozambique, and other countries also. And there are pros and cons in terms of Chinese investments in Chinese infrastructure building in Africa. And I think what the main concern that I have, and some scholars have written about this, is the lack of technology transfer in Africa from Chinese infrastructural building. And it's been extensively written about, and the Chinese are in Africa to stay. And of course, the relationship with African countries is very asymmetrical. There are concerns about Chinese debt in Africa, concerns about technological transfer in Africa. But so in terms of implementation, briefly, and I'm cognizant of the time, financing, you know, where will it come from? Will it come from the traditional bilateral institutions? Will it come from FDI, and what are the preconditions for that? Or will it come from Asia, Japan, and China, and to an extent India, and so forth. So that is basically what I have to say about this. And thank you for having me. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very, very much, Super Satisfy. When you started, you said you're not familiar with Agenda 2063, but this platform is meant to disseminate new knowledge. So I'm happy if you have learned something from that and how the futures model is actually aligned to the goals and aspirations of Agenda 2063 through its 40-year trajectory as we look towards the future. So thank you again for your time and your intervention. And it's really, really good that you are will show interest in this space as well. Without further ado, I want to now quickly go to the last discussant. A dear friend of mine, Mr. Aaron Achopong, is a co-founder and deputy director of AfroSyn, which Dr. Tesfaye alluded to, is a think tank in Ghana. Aaron is passionate about international security and its role in effective governance. His expertise is in international development, intelligence, and security management, and he's also keen on giving back to his community through economic empowerment and social programs. So over to you, Aaron. Are you there? I'm not sure if you...
I think he's in the main session. He might need to be unmuted.
I see. Linda, can you please help us to unmute our speaker? I think he joined from the wrong link.
Hi.
In the meantime, great. So I'm not sure if we'll be able to see you, but please make your intervention.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you, Pamela. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Awesome. So I would also follow, I would want to say, first of all, thank you to AUDA-NEPAD, the Policy Bridge Tank, and also ISS for this incredible work. Let me also point out that I also worked at the Party Center. I went to school at University of Denver. I worked at the Party Center, so I did some work actually on some of the reports that the center did with the ISS and all of that. So it's good to see the work go on. Again, I also want to focus on the issue of infrastructure financing. And when I think about it, when I was reading the report, one of the things that kept coming is that if this, the results that we are seeing or the projections that we have, if this is what leapfrogging is going to mean for Africa, of course, that's, statistically, it is significant. And also, even theoretically or practically, it's very significant. But if you look at the pace at which the rest of the world is going, then as a young scholar and very optimistic Africanist, I get scared. And I think that it is not enough and that the continent could do better. And so for this reason, it's actually frightening to imagine that we are not able to leapfrog or even fall below this threshold. That is going to be a problem for the continent moving forward. And now to the infrastructure financing, which, of course, all the discussants and presenters talked about. I think it's very key, and we really need to start thinking about it critically. So, for example, is Africa going to look internally? How are we going to generate these internal funds, right? We've talked about the Pan-African payment systems, payment and settlement systems, how far we have gone with all of these things. Are questions that we need to find answers to, or we need to compel government, and I think that is the role of AUDA-NEPAD and all of us, to compel African government to sort of fast-track some of these brilliant ideas and systems that are already in the system. I think that would help. Also, as someone who extensively studies Africa, China, I would say that we really need to understand that, and we've admitted that in this report and in some of the reports that AUDA-NEPAD have done with ISS, it is there that China has actually done more in terms of funding infrastructure, be it soft or hard infrastructure on the continent. So if Africa wants to tap into the China, to tap into the China financing program or system, then we really need to understand China more. So that, and again, by understanding China, we need to also admit the complexities and the nuances when it comes to these great power rivalries, right? Because we are seeing that China actually reduced or declined its infrastructure financing after concerns were coming about, you know, debt trap narrative and all of that. But research didn't show that that was the case, right? But again, it affected China-Africa engagement in terms of infrastructure financing. So the what Professor Tesfaye talked about, the idea of getting the African narrative, the idea of we understanding these complexities and nuances, and yet critically assessing, you know, Africa-China engagements and holding both sides accountable would help both Africa and China. For example, you take the FOCAC, which is a principal forum that, you know, formalizes Africa-China engagements. A lot of numbers are thrown about, but as a continent or as you know, the African Union or research centers or other agencies interested in Africa-China, are we really following up, doing the assessment to make sure that these numbers are reflecting on the continent? More importantly, how are we helping African governments to tap into this, right? And also to negotiate well? That issue has come up over and over again. And so I think that in wrapping up and in conclusion, as we think about Africa's infrastructure, we really need to look at the financing aspect, which of course is key in achieving our infrastructure deficits. So whether we are going to look internally or externally, a critical example is the BRICS, right? We could tap into these other multilateral institutions that are coming up. How is Africa leveraging their BRICS, right, to make sure that it is, you know, it is benefiting significantly from it? So these are questions, and I don't know whether our speakers could throw more light onto it and see whether such these conversations came up, you know, in discussing the results of the IF's model that we've seen. So I'll end here, and I'll say thank you again for the opportunity, and I'm so glad that a report like this is out. We'll continue to study it and also see how we can improve upon our work at ASCIR and to support the work that AUDA-NEPAD is doing. Thank you so much, Pamela.
Great. Thank you, Ian, for your intervention. I think what is coming out clearly from today is, in order for Africa to leapfrog further into the future, a number of conditions must be met, and these include investment in infrastructure, having the right regulatory environment for new business models to be tested, and also to pay deliberate attention to research and development, science, technology, as there are many challenges and advances that have been made in leapfrogging in Africa. We have seen the M-Pesa model of Kenya, recently just visited Seychelles, where we have learned that during COVID, the government have rolled out, electronic banking for thousands of its citizens so that they can receive, their grants electronically. So there are a lot, but as we know, a lot more needs to be done. There is one question that is on the chat group. I want to just read it out, and whoever on the panelists are ready to intervene, please feel free. And the question is, as we discuss China-Africa relations, what are your views on the impact of China's recent economic slowdown on infrastructure financing in Africa moving forward? So anyone, Professor Tesfaye, Frida, as well as Jakkie on the line, or Haran, who was just intervened, you're welcome to make your inputs. Thank you.
Thanks, Pamela. I'll say a word or two about that, and then maybe some of the other panelists can come in. We run a blog series. Let me first say that on the website, there's quite a lot about China in Africa, both on our current path forecast, which is the first theme on the website, as well as there's a theme on financial flows. And the theme on financial flows looks at foreign direct investment. It looks at aid, ODI. It looks at remittances, and it looks at illicit financial outflows. And we model the impact of that on Africa. And then there is a in the section in the theme that we presented today on large infrastructure, there is, of course, also quite a bit on China. So a bit of background, but as we all know, the nature of Chinese engagement with Africa has shifted away from the large mega projects to smaller, let's call it not fundable, but projects that that they feel is less risky, because China's the amount of Chinese financial assistance has declined, and there's a concern that those large pots of money that Africa was able to borrow from have declined, but also that Africa's ability to repay has declined. And one of the blogs that we've recently written, or a number of the blogs that we've recently written, and I would recommend that people subscribe to our blogs, really deal with the debt challenge. As we know, 21 or 22 African countries are in debt distress or approaching debt distress. And it again just points to the importance of the reform of the international financial institutions and the challenges that the continent face, because we have a huge financial need. And most of that money is locked up in the West, if you're looking particularly at private sector money. State money comes from China, but when you're looking at accessing your private flows, and private flows are larger to Africa than this whole narrative on debt trap diplomacy. But to do that, a lot needs to change, including the way that the risk agencies deal with Africa and so on. So it's a very complicated issue, but ultimately it comes down to changes and reform that is required in the international financial system and the way in which Africa is seen. And that, of course, depends a lot about stability and predictability on the African continent. So I'll stop there, but there's a lot on the website. And if you subscribe, or the listeners, the viewers subscribe to our newsletter, they will get the blogs and this kind of stuff. Everything there is available.
Just to add a few words to Jakkie's presentation, you know, the challenge for African countries in terms of Chinese financing of infrastructure or Chinese investment in Africa is discerning investment, Chinese investment from foreign assistance and loan. It's all tied in together, and it's very difficult really to discern it. But having said that, clearly there is the issue of African debt, but also in instances there have also been the Chinese have forgiven some of the debt of selected African countries. But overall, you know, the slowdown of Chinese investment in Africa in terms of building infrastructure indicates that, you know, such investment really in the long term cannot be counted on. And so African countries, sub-Saharan African countries, must either generate such investments from internal sources, or seek alternative forms of financing, either from the European countries or the United States or other sources and so forth. Thank you.
Hello, Pamela, if I may.
Thank you. Yes, please go ahead, Aaron. Thanks.
Yes, so I would say fundamentally that if Africa is going to benefit from this engagement with China, and I think this is something AACIR has stressed quite, you know, significantly, is that it would depend mainly on the agency of the African continent or African countries. There's a brilliant research that was done, and this goes back to the idea of the IGFs. We find that most African businesses, right, they do business without actually financial flows, right? So they do the business, but the monies do not come to the continent, right? So you have Chinese business people on the continent who ask their fellow Chinese in China to send materials or products to be sold on the continent. And the money is paid from a Chinese bank in China to the Chinese supplier in China, right? So the money doesn't go from doesn't come, the products come from China to Africa, but the money doesn't go from Africa to China, right? So we, the African governments lose a lot of money from that. They lose a lot of taxes and all of that. So the huge loopholes and gaps, right, that it would take African governments and agencies to really start looking into these things critically. We've had scenarios where foreign businesses in on the continent would actually pack money as products and send them back to their home countries like China without using their banking systems, right? And so we lose the money. So you see that African investment or trade with China is growing, and yet we do not see the impact on the ground. So there are a lot of challenges there, and I think that it would mainly depend on African governments. And one of the problems I find is that, that is why I'm so glad that AUDA-NEPAD is doing this, that most African governments are paying less and less attention to research, are paying less and less attention to think tanks. And I think it's about time that African governments start consulting or using data and research that think tanks and agencies are producing so that they can really know what is going on and that they can, you know, sort of fill these loopholes. One example I can give is that we had a meeting with some Chinese diplomats, and they were asking the question, if the Pan-African payment system and settlement system works, how can we integrate that with the CHIPS, that is the Chinese, you know, cross-border payment system, right? So there are so many ways that Africa can leverage its engagements with China, but we aren't, even internally. And externally, it's worse, because we go to FOCAC, they say they are giving us this money or we are going to commit this into that. And African governments do not even know how to assess these funds. And then we go back after 3 years and then the cycle repeats itself. So to answer your question, I think that African agencies, the African Union, African governments must pay key attention to the China story and really start thinking critically about how we can leverage. Because if we're expecting China to come and do it, it wouldn't work. And they wouldn't. Right, so Africans would need to step up and take the charge, and that is why I'm very happy with this report that the ISS and AUDA-NEPAD have brought out. Thank you so much, Pamela. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Aaron. Frida, do you have any last parting comments on that question or any other that you'd like to comment on?
Yes, just briefly. I think that Dr. Tesfaye also hit on a point that I think we often do not leverage, which is our own internally generated funds. And I think earlier in the year, I was at another infrastructure financing summit that AUDA-NEPAD hosted in Dakar. And we had a great discussion amongst, you know, some of our own local banks around how we can use pension funds and other types of funds to support our infrastructure development. Of course, it cannot probably cover all of that, but an area that we really need to look into and also develop. And I think the second thing that I wanted to also talk about is that practically, I feel like our governments don't talk enough to each other. When we look at China, all of us have bilateral agreements with the Chinese that we don't really have much visibility into contracting. And I think we will never leverage these economies of scale or get these regional trade benefits if we don't communicate about the opportunities for us to leverage, you know, and be smart about our contracting and come as a group, as opposed to individual nations contracting the same quote unquote, you know, provider in a sense. And so I don't really have an answer to how we overcome that outside of communication and governments being able to be open with each other. But I think that's something that could also help in terms of our negotiation with the Chinese government.
Great, thank you. Thank you so much. I think a lot of what you've said now, you know, we can't predict, but also the space is very interesting with the, you know, latest BRICS, you know, discussions. Additional countries are joining on board of the BRICS. this is, you know, really going to we have to watch out for the future in terms of watching how the South-South, you know, collaboration takes place and what support we can leverage. But more importantly, the benefits to the countries is very critical. There was a comment, but I see Jakkie had responded to it. There was a comment about that this was, session provided a very good quantitative approach. And the question was about a qualitative process, including a social dynamics and norms and cohesion. But Jakkie did indicate on the response that there are available data on this or content on this website that speaks to both governance, demographics, job creation. But Jakkie, if you want to add maybe a last comment on the social dynamics and cohesion of the quantitative content that you have presented, please.
Thanks, Pamela. There is, you know, we try to get at some of these issues. There are some matters, of course, that is more difficult to deal with. Again, to re-emphasize that we do forecasting at a national level for every African country. But of course, in that process, we lose a lot of granularity when you look at subnational trends. We also look at inequality using Gini and other measures. But to really get to the extent to which we deal at a national level, you have to, on the website, go to the geographical section. There are certain countries recently, we've just finished updating Morocco, for example. We're busy with Algeria. We actually also working on Mali and so on and so forth. So there you please do have a look at the geographical analysis where we apply these scenarios to each African country. And we look at what is the impact of various matters on the future of Africa, including inward financial flows, something that was mentioned, as well as governance and so on. So, but I must admit that there are certain areas, of course, certain contexts that inevitably we must, even as we try and get at a national level to each and every African country and region. What we've done today is something that we often get criticized for, and that is that we've made something, we've sort of shown some of the differences between sub-Saharan Africa and North Africa. And from a developmental perspective, there are very large differences. People, there is often the comment, yes, but Africa is a single continent, but if you want to point to differences, that is one of the important sets of differences that you can point to. And the other one, of course, is to look at the colonial legacies, Francophone, Lusophone, and so on and so forth. And the other one is to look at the low versus low middle versus upper middle and Africa's single high income country and look at those differences. But these are different ways to be able to compare, because that's really where our strength lies, and that is to compare the situation in different African countries, not only with one another, but also with other developing regions. And typically the two regions that we also use today is to compare the situation with South America and with South Asia. But I think that's enough from my side. Thanks very much, Pamela.
Please. Thank you. Thank you, Jakkie. I see a hand from Hatumba Farada. If you, if your mic is on, please pose your question or make your comment. Thank you. I'm not sure if the hand has disappeared, if that was a mistake. Are you wanting to still speak but don't have access to your mic?
No. Hello?
Linda?
Can you hear me, please?
Yes, I can hear you. Please go ahead, sir. We can hear you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Jakkie, and a blessing for your nice presentations. Thank you, Dr. Jakkie. I think we have seen again. We have joined before yesterday on the presentations on the different aspects of African situations, on the African development, the current and the scenarios in the future, on the potential of African economy and the impact of world on the Africa on different scenarios. Thank you so much for your efforts, for your analysis and presentations on these areas. What I am thinking is we have seen the impact of leapfrogging and also infrastructures and other development sectors on African today's and future developments. But what I am thinking is, what is the current situation going on Africa, especially on Sub-Saharan and the Horn of Africa, is the political instabilities. Have you seen the impact of political instabilities on our future development? Have you added this one on your current, or what you have think about the current situation of our political instabilities going in Africa? The second one is, as we have seen before yesterday, the African population from 2019 to 2043 was more than doubled. So have you seen the impact of this population growing on our Africa's development, please? Thank you so much.
Pamela, shall I just respond directly?
Please,
go ahead. So the African Futures and Innovation Program is one program within a much larger institute, the Institute for Security Studies. And as the name indicates, the rest of the institute deals extensively with instability and conflict in Africa. And we have offices in Addis Ababa and Dakar, in Nairobi, and a number of consultants across the continent. We have staff from more than 22 African countries. So we do a lot of work on trying to understand what is driving instability and conflict. Having said that, I think that we must recognize that a number of recent shocks have driven instability in Africa. We can start with the 2007-2008 financial crisis. We can follow that up with the impact of COVID, and then we can look at the impact of the war on Russia's invasion of Ukraine on general economic growth. The results of these factors, but particularly COVID, has been that governments that we've seen debt increase, we've seen growth plummet, and the result is that the revenues of African governments have fallen through the floor. They have less money to spend on education, on health, on security. And the result is that instability has increased. So that, combined with a youth bulge and all kinds of other things, are the structural drivers of the increase in instability. And the Institute the rest of the Institute does a lot of work on trying to understand the granularity. And then recently, if you want to then step down, until the death of the head of Wagner, Russia was playing a particular role also in a number of African countries that served to support and feed into a rising tide of former colonial issues, and providing a degree of security to countries like Mali, Central African Republic, and so on. So it's a complicated mix. We do the structural stuff. The second question you asked was population growth. I'll ask Tamsin just to pop a link in the chat function. We've done a lot of work on population. I know that Pamela knows this very well. Africa's very rapidly growing population is a huge drag on the improvement on incomes. You know, we often say that Africa is a very young population, the future belongs to us. It's true. But our population is growing so rapidly that you can't build schools and hospitals and so on rapidly enough. And we must get on top of our very rapidly population growth. If you want to be able to improve incomes, and we've done a lot of work on that. Go to the demographics section on the website, and it's one of the themes, and there we expand very extensively on the benefits, but also the potential challenges that we face with regard to Africa's, the fact that we only get on average to Africa's demographic, we enter a potential demographic dividend only in about two decades' time. Until then, demographics is in actual fact a drag on growth in Africa. It reduces over time, but that's the problem. But And subscribe and have a look at our subscribe to our blogs and have a look at our at the events that are coming up. But I think I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Jakkie. There's just one more hand up from Patrice Young. I don't want to end the session, although we have just 3 minutes remaining. But please go ahead, Patrice Young, with your question or your comment. Linda, please unmute yourself. I see that you are still unmuted. Patrice Young, who has raised her hand.
Thank you very much, Moderator Pamela. I'm very happy. Thanks to AUDA-NEPAD for the organization of this profound reflection on Africa's development. My comment, I don't have a question. My comment is that from the presentation of Dr. Jakkie, Dr. Blessing, Dr. Frida, Professor, and the last panelist, we are coming back to one thing. The problem with our development, it's Africans among themselves, nations, economic blocs, we are not honest, sincere in our bilateral and multilateral relations. That is why our financial dependence still persists. We have been able, through the assistance of your organization, to depict the shortcomings of African development in terms of countries, in terms of the continent. But as Dr. Frida pointed out, most of our governments, they don't look at the important sector in which to invest. For a country or a continent to develop, you have education, health, agriculture, scientific research. But most of our government, they put in more in terms of military weapons. And as one of my previous speakers said, Africa is plagued with a lot of unnecessary conflict. And one of the panelists talked of not being able of controlling the flow of currency entering our continent and going out. So at the end of the day, as Dr. Frida pointed out, I think the governments of Africa, if they are not able to talk together sincerely, honestly, we cannot compete with the other world, that is with the other continent. Look, for instance, I'll end there. All the economic bloc of Africa, I've hardly seen a gathering where you find CEMAC, you find ECOWAS, you find the Eastern Economic Bloc and North Africa sitting together to talk about this large-scale infrastructure, energy, solar energy, wind energy, and ICT. Whereas these are very, very, very important things to sit and talk about. Then lastly, Africa will not be able to leapfrog if we cannot have that movement, free movement of people from one country to the other and free goods. The only economic bloc in Africa that has that free movement is ECOWAS, where people can move from one country to the other, separate anywhere without constraint as well as goods. So once more, I thank you so much. And I hope in the near future, we'll continue to be exchanging on this point. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your comment. I think the comment, you know, the point on honesty and sincerity is indeed valid. I think trust forms the bedrock of any development agenda that we can discuss on a daily basis. So you've made a very, very valid and pertinent point. And if that is addressed, I think financial flows and illicit financial, you know, or tax avoidance, all of that will be eradicated. But we are, you know, we can only think for the positive trajectory that these sessions have demonstrated, and for governments and policymakers to align themselves with some of the findings that are coming out, and the, you know, forward-looking trajectories that are coming out of these studies to inform their policy making, which indeed will then take them on that honesty and sincere pathway of Africa's development. So with that, if there's no other comments, I would like to take this opportunity of thanking our esteemed panelists, Professor Tesfai, Frida, Arend, Jakkie, and Blessing. Thank you very much to you, the supporters, and participants of this session. I would also like to use this opportunity to thank the teams of ISS and AUDA-NEPAD for your support, as well as the ISS Partnership Forum, which is the Hans Snedel Foundation, the European Union, the Open Source Foundations, and the government of Denmark, Ireland, Netherlands, Norway, as well as Sweden. So you will see from that list, we are not just, you know, giving you information that is, just brought up from one institution, but supported from various institutions in the way we address our development agenda. I also want to bring to your attention that the next event will take place on the 1st of September, this being the fifth of the last series, the sixth, fifth of the sixth series that we had in this foresight analysis. And that will be on the 1st of September on how could governance improve development outputs. So please watch your emails for that information. And as I leave you now, please take a few minutes. You will find a poll that will come up on your screen. I encourage you to please assist us in completing that. It helps us improve our future sessions and improve on how we can deliver content, both new and relevant content to you. So with that, I wish you a wonderful rest of the Friday afternoon and enjoy your weekend. Thank you very much for your support again.